Once upon a time, the Arctic was an empty and seldom traveled place. The frozen wreckage of 18th-century exploration ships and the occasional military outpost were among the only sign of human visitation. This is no longer the case. Increasingly, commercial flights are plotting courses over the North Pole and the Arctic tundra. With that in mind, you may be wondering what's prompting these excursions over the frozen North. I'll get to that in just a bit. Even though flights like this are becoming common, there are still a number of obstacles that can get in the way. And no, violating Santa's airspace isn't one of them. However, the elves are pretty annoying. Commercial flights have been crossing the Arctic off and on for several decades, but most modern transpolar airways didn't come into full use until 1998. Nonstop flights over long distances consume a lot of fuel. Consuming less fuel often requires carrying less weight, which translates to fewer passengers and lighter cargo. Fewer passengers and less cargo mean fewer profits, making the trip not worth the airline's time. It wasn't until the last 40 years that aircraft range and carrying capacity increased to the point that Arctic routes became profitable on a large scale. Aircraft today are free to pass through the Arctic in large numbers, but that wasn't always the case. A mere 20 years ago, flights across the North Pole were scarce. At that time, there were tight restrictions on how many aircraft could cross Russia's polar airspace. Planes could technically complete the trip, but Siberian airspace was tightly controlled by the Russian government, which allowed only a handful of crossings every day. It was only after a lengthy period of negotiations that the region was opened up to mass transit. Frankly, I'm not sure why Santa didn't get a seat at the table, but I guess he didn't have as much political clout as I thought. Ho ho ho. Countries obviously like having the ability to control their own airspace, and many treaties exist for the sole purpose of determining who can fly where and when. Scheduling an international flight relies on having a friendly, or at least civil, relationship with everyone along the way. This can make things much more complicated than they might seem at first. When Air India became the first Indian carrier to fly across the Arctic Circle, their planes had to pass through the airspace of six countries as they progressed from New Delhi to San Francisco. Proceeding as planned required them to receive permission and cooperation from everyone along the way. This has always been an obstacle in planning international flights, and is no less of a problem when it comes to crossing the North Pole. One problem that's unique to the poles is the lack of infrastructure. Even today, airfields capable of supporting large aircraft are few and far between. And trust me, things are a lot better now than they were in the late 90s, when there was a severe disagreement on whether Arctic air travel was even possible on a large scale. Compasses are useless when you're that close to one of the Earth's magnetic poles, and satellites aren't much help either. Most of the satellites used for aircraft navigation orbit the Earth in geosynchronous orbit. This means that they orbit in sync with the Earth's rotation, allowing them to always be in the same position relative to the surface of the Earth. This type of orbit is only possible when the satellite is moving west to east near the equator. While this setup works most of the time, it creates a blind spot along the poles. Navigating near the North Pole is heavily reliant on a combination of radar, GPS navigation, and communication with the controllers on the ground. Much of that infrastructure had to be built from the ground up over the last 15 to 20 years. Before that, the only radar stations in the Arctic Circle were the military outposts I mentioned earlier. Many of them were constructed in the 50s and 60s and had no system to decipher the radio transponders civilian aircraft used to identify themselves. There were also concerns that they may not be accurate or reliable enough to keep up with industry standards. They could track a plane's movement, but the system was never intended to coordinate a large number of aircraft on overlapping flight paths. A system also needed to be devised for Russian, American, and Canadian air traffic controllers to communicate with each other effectively. While these issues were mostly resolved, the process was extremely expensive. Airlines had to, more or less, create an entirely new sector of Canada's economy, and there are still restrictions on which planes can attempt the journey. The scarcity of airfields and refueling stations means that only planes with a range of 8,000 miles or more are permitted to traverse the Arctic airways. As a result, only major carriers can afford to send flights over the Arctic Circle. The aircraft themselves also need to be specially equipped for an Arctic voyage. Even with additional radar infrastructure, aircraft still require specialized navigation systems to remain on course as they soar above the Arctic ice. These planes are also required to carry safety devices not found on routine flights. This includes things like cold weather gear for the crew and emergency radios. Airliners on Arctic routes also have predetermined locations where they can make emergency landings. Similarly, the crews are trained in special evacuation procedures just in case they need to land under less than ideal circumstances. While this possibility has never become a reality, it's always good to be prepared when passing through such a hostile and sparsely populated region. One recently declassified project, codenamed Rudolph, was said to have involved ultra-high-intensity light for navigation purposes, especially through fog, using a particular color the Russian government would be guaranteed not to find offensive. But the deal did not materialize. At this point, you may be wondering what makes Arctic flights worth so much trouble. Why are airlines willing to spend millions of dollars on special planes and expanded facilities? Well, it turns out these journeys across the Arctic Circle are much faster than you'd expect. We all know that the quickest way to get somewhere is a straight line. So, depending on where you're going, an Arctic flight can potentially shave hours off your trip. Are you in New York and want to visit Hong Kong? Traditionally, that would mean flying west with one or more stops along the way. That's nearly 20 hours in the air, not to mention the layovers. By contrast, flying from New York to Hong Kong across the Arctic Circle clocks in at around 16 hours. That's still quite a long flight, but I'd take 16 hours over 18 any day of the week. Passengers on transpolar flights also tend to experience less turbulence thanks to the lower temperatures found at the far north. And since we're on the subject of added perks, flying over the North Pole offers passengers a rare glimpse at the top of the world. A glimpse that's extra clear since the freezing temperatures forces planes to fly at a much lower altitude when crossing the poles. Hey, maybe you'll even get to see elves. Okay, that probably isn't very likely, but those lucky enough to land a window seat are in for a real visual treat. Is there anywhere you'd love to get a bird's eye view of? Why don't you let me know in the comments? Airlines have several reasons to offer these Arctic voyages, with the main ones being cost and turnaround. Jets require a lot of fuel to get where they're going, and while 2 hours might not seem like a lot, the costs can add up quickly. For every hour in the air, a Boeing 747 consumes over $9,000 worth of fuel, and that's by no means the most expensive plane to fly. When 2 hours translates to almost $20,000, it suddenly sounds like a much better deal. Well, it's a little bit like getting a high-efficiency dishwasher or putting solar panels on your roof. Sure, you're spending a lot of money all at once, but it's in the hope of saving even more in the future. For the airlines who can't afford the upfront cost, Arctic flights can be extremely profitable. Not every carrier is ready and able to begin offering transpolar flights, but as time passes, the route will continue to become more accessible. Maybe someday, you might book a flight on Santa Air. Hey, it could happen. Alright, if you learned something new today, then give the video a like and share it with a friend. And here are some other cool videos I think you'll enjoy. Just click to the left or right, and remember, stay on the bright side of life.